Succession is a drama comedy about the Roy family, owners of the largest media and entertainment company in the world, as they struggle to find a successor while fending off external and internal forces that seek their downfall. The pilot starts off with the patriarch, Logan Roy, having a stroke that makes the family and the higher-ups of the company realize they need a succession plan in case that Logan dies. This ignites tension and competition between the four siblings, Kendall Roy, Roman Roy, Siobhan Roy, and Connor Roy. Kendall Roy pines the most for the position of CEO and bases his eligibility on his credentials, yet his issues with sobriety are roadblocks in his attempts to assume power. This is Kendall's primary conflict that continues throughout the two seasons. The most visible conflict of the show's two seasons, however, is the overbearing and controlling attitude and behaviors of Logan Roy. Logan Roy embodies the negative characteristics society attributes to millionaires and CEOs, and this is demonstrated in his relationships with his children and workers. The rest of the Roys also embody these negative attributes, and this is seen in their respective relationships, whether personal or professional. However, despite their negative traits, we do sympathize with the Roys and even get enjoyment from them. In seasons 1 and 2, we root for Kendall Roy, laugh at Roman and Connor, and go, "Yes, Queen," for Siobhan. But these are still people who are disgustingly rich and are able to get away with anything. The plot of Succession creates two conflicting meanings, detesting the bourgeois behaviors and actions of the Roy family, and having sympathy for the struggles of the Roy children. Was there ever a time that we thought billionaires were good people? First off, let us make the difference between millionaires and billionaires. I'm no mathematician nor economics major, but with the help of social media, we can distinguish between the
millionaires and billionaires.
So this guy on TikTok just helps us visualize the numbers. Basic stuff like how many millions are in 1 billion.
Okay, so the moment you've been waiting for, 100K, 1 million, 1 billion, Jeff Bezos has 122 of these, or 58 pounds of rice, if each grain of rice was 100K. Like, look how big this is, guys. I'm gonna show you the scale here. I'm gonna put a keyboard in just for fun. Look how deep that goes. That's insane. This is Jeff Bezos' new house that's $145 million in LA. And then, oh my God.
While paying attention to the numbers, one should also pay attention to the different perceptions of millionaires and billionaires. In his book, The Billion Dollar Secret, Rafael Badzia claims that billionaires enjoy making and saving money rather than spending it. And this is the reason why billionaires have a grandiose accumulation of wealth. This has contributed to the growth and popularization of the term billionaire hoarder. The concept of billionaire hoarder contributes to the differences between millionaires and billionaires. For example, Dolly Parton would be a billionaire if it weren't for her consistent donations to her community and the 1 million donation to the development of the Moderna vaccine. Dolly Parton, in a way, is a millionaire sweetheart to society, whereas Jeff Bezos is the billionaire Grinch. It also does not help that since the Reagan administration, the rich have gotten richer by $21 trillion. Imagine how much rice that is. Going off of those same statistics, the lower and middle classes have lost around $900 billion. And this is with productivity and hours going up and the wages changing very little. This big income disparity has greatly contributed to class tension that has been dubbed "Eat the Rich," as seen in the comment section of the Billion Rice video. Eat the Rich is in line with revolutionary thought, particularly referencing certain things from the French Revolution, such as the guillotine, bread, etc. It has also become evident in recent media as films such as Hustlers and Parasite have highlighted class warfare. And such class warfare has labeled billionaires and people who finesse the system without giving back to society as evil people. The rich are depicted as having no moral compass, damaging those in the lower class, and having hedonistic behaviors. They are also cold, lethal, and selfish. Succession's cast of characters embody every word of those last few sentences said. Show creator Jesse Armstrong has said that in creating the show, he envisioned the Roys as a modern-day Murdoch family. The producers of Succession do a really good job of depicting how the 0.01% live. Before watching the episode, the intro and theme song remind the audience of the show's characters and premise. The intercut shots of past family video footage, the present family, the aspects of the media company, and the city reflect the kind of company that is Waystar Roy Co., and the kind of family that is the Roy family. Logan Roy, the CEO and patriarch, with Murdoch-esque influence, inherited a print shop and from there on built what is the fifth largest media conglomerate in the world. Companies like Waystar are going extinct, that is, companies that rose from the ground up and are being family run. Let us also pay attention to the footage of the family, both in the past and the present. The first shot is of a son and a father who is obviously a middle-aged Logan Roy. Given that the conflict between Kendall Roy and Logan Roy is given the most attention, it can be deduced that the well-suited child is Kendall Roy. The elegance that the father and son exude continue in the footage that follows. Exterior and interior shots of the mansion equipped with all the wealthy signifiers: a tennis court, a pool, classical paintings, chandeliers, servants. Even only daughter Siobhan Roy has fulfilled the "daddy, can I have a pony" cliche. But the point is that we know that the Roy family is rich. As I stated before, being rich doesn't mean you have to be a bad person. Even being a millionaire, as Dolly Parton has shown us, doesn't equate an individual to be evil. As lectured to me by my mother and the adults who raised me, it is your actions that make you a bad person. And taking from Raphael Badziak's idea, I propose the idea that perhaps being a billionaire does make you a bad person. The action of hoarding money is already selfish, and it is made even worse when there is no returning contribution to society, or to those in need. Paying taxes for institutions that could help out the lower and middle classes. And the Roys, who are billionaires, fall under this category. Yet, if there is some way that billionaires were made out to be more evil, Succession has mastered this depiction. Of all the despicable things that the Roys and their insiders do, which I should mention include Siobhan's fiancé Tom Wamsgans and family cousin Greg, they do everything from covering up murders and sexual assault on their cruise ships.
We can minimize the incident to avoid negative PR.
Incidents like
theft, sexual assault, rape, murder.
Okay, the bad ones.
To eating a deep-fried songbird and getting a ride off of the shame.
The exact purpose is debated. Some say it's to mask the shame, others to heighten the pleasure.
To Roman speeding up a project that results in a failed rocket launch. The worst symbolic thing that the Roys have done is in the pilot episode. Although the perpetrator in this case is Roman Roy, the youngest son, I say all the Roys because, as you will see, everyone is in on it, either through active participation or being a bystander.
You're gonna be fine. Relax. Don't worry about it. Can you hit a ball?
Yeah.
Great, because I will give you $1 million if you hit a home run. I'm dead serious, okay?
For real?
Yes, for real. $1 million. Honey, where's the, your bag?
Hey, I'll do it for $1 million. Give me that. Just kidding, you're good.
All right. I don't know why you're smiling. I am dead serious. I will give you $1 million cash for a home fucking run.
Rome, don't be an asshole.
Not being an asshole. I want him incentivized. This is fun. It's a game. Jeez, stop being so serious. Huh? Witnesses? Good luck. I believe in you. All right, let's do this. $1 million. Okay, come on.
Whoa!
That's it.
Run, kid!
That's a hit. That's a damn hit.
Run,
come on, Ship. I'm here, Ship. Come on,
Tommy.
No.
Come on. Come on, run faster.
Kid.
No!
Bad luck, kid.
Oh no! You were so damn close. That was so close. Oh my goodness. Oh, that's so sad. Oh, I'm sorry. I can't give it to you. That would have counted, by the way. That was almost a home run if you went all the way around. But it was a really good effort. Really, quite tremendous. So take this back to your life. It's 250,000. Enjoy.
Son.
was never.
Thank you.
Magnificent.
And trust me, Kieran Culkin is an amazing actor because this scene and the sound of his voice made me wanna. Although Logan Roy tells the kid magnificent effort, the child and his parents still remain in their class and are given this emotionally damaging reminder, and unfortunately the Roys stay in their position of power. They stay in this untouchable cloud where they can do horrible things like this and not bear any responsibility for their actions. Eric Deegans of NPR states that Succession, like many other TV shows depicting the rich, are like cautionary tales exposing how wealth and power can destroy empathy and family unity. As Succession executive producer and director Adam McKay states, it demonstrates that dynastic wealth rotting through values and morals, step by step, case after case. This is why we hate the rich. Not because of the obvious economic inequality, but the fact that they get away with it, which just rubs salt on the wound. Yet, if there is a victory that ordinary people have over these obscenely wealthy people, it is our possession of morals, and at least, most of us have a stable relationship with others. Alyssa Rosenberg of The Washington Post makes the point that, quote, "The rich are different from me and you. They have the ability to cause themselves more problems than the rest of us could even begin to imagine. They just cannot purchase self-discipline or self-respect or a father's favor." I guess Biggie was right.
The more money you make, the more problems you get.
And of the internal and external problems of the Roys, with Connor Roy only having a relationship because of his sugar baby Willa, Roman being unable to be intimate with his girlfriend, and from Rosenberg again, Golden Girl Shiv blowing up her career as a lefty political strategist, her marriage to Tom, and her reputation as a decent human. Even the patriarch Logan Roy can't defy time. His body is failing, especially at inopportune moments. Whatever amount of happiness we have in our lives is invaluable, and the possessions of the Roys pale in comparison. Well, almost. If there is another thing to comfort us when we bear witness to their terrible actions, is the schadenfreude. One of the brilliant things the writers of Succession do is make their suffering comical and at times pitiful. This scene of boar on the floor, where Logan Roy attempts to fish out his followers who do not agree with Waystar making an acquisition because it is risky, etc. All of these filthy rich people who have also done evil things are pitted against each other, and Logan Roy is on top. It shows how the wealthy are humiliated as well. I mean, fighting for a sausage on the floor and being forced to oink.
No, no half-hearted oink. I want full-hearted oink.
Oink, 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 oink!
On the count of three, the last piggy to eat a sausage is the mole.
That doesn't seem like a very good system.
Greg, oink! Two. One.
I got it!
Get it, Greg!
Come on! Go, 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 go! That's my fucking sausage!
You
come on! Carl stole my sausage! Carl stole my sausage!
Rosenberg, who I quoted time and time again so far, wrote the New York Times op-ed titled, "We Can't Beat the Elites. Succession lets us hope they might punish themselves." And yes, there is a lot of backstabbing, scheming, and mocking of these characters by these characters that we don't even have to do it for them. I mean, just look at these clips.
Hey, listen. At least I'm only getting fucked by one member of this family, yeah?
You should see the other guy.
The guy who jammed his dick in your eye?
According to this, it sounds like a stroke, but it could be an acute subdural hematoma.
Great, get in there and operate, Dr. Google.
These people hurt themselves and each other, wearing down each other's self-esteem that results in true sadness.
I wonder if the sad I'd be without you would be less than the sad I get from being with you.
Thank you. Out of the sadness for these characters comes sympathy. Nearing the end of season 1, when Kendall Roy proposes a vote of no confidence because his dad is barely recovering from his medical emergency and he believes that his dad does bad business deals such as investing in legacy media.
We bought local TV.
Dad, nobody watches TV.
Why shouldn't we do all the news?
Well, Kim Jong Pop, because that's not how things work in this country.
We spend so much time with Kendall, witnessing his plan to overthrow his father and the effort he puts into it, only to have it fail. And it is ironic how the action to overthrow his father is the reason why his coup fails. He has taken the helicopter from Manhattan to Long Island to secure a vote from one of the company's board members. This trip is the reason he's not able to reach the meeting in person. We see how his helicopter can't take him because the air is under lockdown from a possible terrorist attack. He takes the limo from Long Island to Manhattan but is stuck in traffic being unable to call in until he gets out of his limo and starts running to his office. This scene is tense. We see the board members who agreed to Kendall's plan second-guess their decision when they see that he is not there. Kendall's right-hand man in the coup, Frank Vernon, tries to buy time through roll call.
Our Royco to order. Roll call.
What?
Logan
roll
Roy?
Call?
Yeah, you're here.
We've never done roll call. What is roll
We're
call?
We're doing it today.
Frank, why are we doing roll call today?
Because that's how we do it, right, Noah? So Logan Roy is here.
And this is where cinematography makes its entrance.
Try to do the best by them because I love them.
Have you thought about the possibility that your children are actually scared of you?
Oh, fuck off.
The whole season is filmed with a mockumentary kind of style. This means handheld, zoom in, zoom out, and quick movements from one character to another. This decision in cinematography is to exhibit the reactions and emotions of the characters. We hold on Kendall's face whenever he is sad, which happens a lot in the show. In this particular clip, the handheld with the zoom in, zoom outs, plus the amount of close-ups and medium close-ups serve to include the viewer on the tension. In short, it helps us invest in the character's troubles, and this wouldn't be achieved if it were a steady and distant camera. With investment comes sympathy, and I know what you're thinking. Paula, how can we even feel bad for these people? You literally argued reasons why we should at least dislike them. Okay, I know, but as I stated in the previous section, these are hopeless human beings. How many wins do they exactly have? They're not happy. And despair is literally a part of them. And despite the highs that wealth provides them, their highs are, like all highs, temporary. We see this toxic food chain where the Roy blood relatives abuse each other and those below them, which is Tom, who in turn bullies Greg, the new outsider. I mean, this family hires the most expensive therapist, world-renowned, and they can't even start a dialogue.
Everything I've done in my life, I've done for my children. I know I've made mistakes, but I've always tried to do the best by them because they mean everything to me.
Okay. That was great.
Thank you.
Well, that's nice.
It is nice.
Yeah, sure. No, agreed.
So, what do we feel about what we just heard here?
I mean, I hear it. I hear it.
Uh-huh. Big words. Good words.
Oh, I'm still processing, but yeah.
Oh, and the therapist leaves missing teeth.
Makes it look worse than it actually.
Remember the guy who played that horrible joke on that middle class family? Well, look at this clip. Here he is not being scolded by his father, but being belittled. Oh, and then here's him being hit. Now, which family is better? And I'm hoping that most families are like these middle class people. Warm. Humane. Not like these humans, who are starved of love, compassion, and humanity. So this clear emotional disparity between viewers and characters results in our sympathy and some support. Succession, although an HBO show about a cutthroat family, has a good amount of viewer engagement. Far from the true nature of their characters, here we have audiences create things to make the characters appear happy or successful. One of the things that show this is the use of fan cams. For those who don't know, Urban Dictionary defines fan cams as a video of a celebrity, usually taken by a fan, and used on Twitter. Viewers literally take their time to make these videos and post them. There are also social media accounts dedicated to the funny and/or quirky moments of the show. They are labeled as the no-context/out-of-context. The viewer engagement on social media proves how, despite the Roy family can be horrendous, evil, belittling, mocking, straight out, cold, even murder people by accident, it goes to show that these people and everything that makes up them can create a drama that is interesting and that makes people tune in every week.